Hey there, my name's Gary Sims, and this is Gary Explains. Now, there are three major operating systems that we use on the desktop. The most popular is Windows. Then, of course, you've got Mac OS, but that's only available for Apple hardware. And then you've got Linux, which runs on just about anything. Today's video, we're going to be looking at the differences between Windows and Linux. So if you want to find out more, please let me explain. Okay, so I've broken up this video into three major sections. In the first part, we're going to look at the history and how we got to where we are today. Where did Linux come from? Where did Windows come from? In the second part, we're going to be looking at the developer aspects of writing programs, GUI apps and console apps for the two different operating systems. And in doing that, we're going to actually look at some of the nature of those operating systems. And then in the third part, we're going to look at where Linux has been successful and where Linux has not been successful, where Windows has been successful and when Windows has not been successful, comparing and contrasting the different areas that they have excelled in. Okay, let's get cracking. Okay then, so Windows versus Linux. Windows is a proprietary operating system released by Microsoft. Linux is an open source operating system, which means all of the source code is available, including for the Linux kernel and other Linux components, command line stuff, desktops and so on. Windows is commercial. Linux can also be commercial. Don't think just because it's open source, it means it's free. If you want support for it, if you want training, if you want other kinds of commercial services related to Linux, then of course they are available. And big companies like IBM through Red Hat and so on offer a successful Linux businesses, Oracle as well. But often, of course, the distros themselves are free for you to use. Ubuntu and Mint and all the others, Fedora, all the other ones you want to list. And we'll talk more about that later. So basically the difference between a proprietary operating system from Microsoft, open source, both can be commercial, but Linux can also, and more often than not, is also free to use. But is that all? Is there more to this? Well, of course, there's more to it than just that. So let's dive in a bit deeper. So let's have a quick look at the history, 1986 to 1990. This is what Windows looked like back then. So released in 1986, Windows 1 was a graphical shell on top of MS-DOS. Remember, at the time, PCs came with just a command line operating system called MS-DOS. Didn't do multitasking, couldn't access very much memory, 16-bit. And Microsoft released a shell on top of that that would give you some kind of way of running small applications, file managers, and so on. Windows 2 came out in 1987, allowed Windows to overlap. Windows 3 came out in 1990 and sold 10 million copies. So that was a very successful product for Microsoft. This is 1990. This is before Linux was even announced. So we're at Windows 3 before Linux even existed. Now in 1991, the Linux kernel is publicly announced on 25th of August by Linus Torvalds. Linus Linux, that's why it's called Linux. And there's a picture of Linus. And I'm doing a free operating system, just a hobby. Won't be big and professional like GNU for 386 and 486 AT clones. That was his original announcement. Yes, it's free of any Minix code and it has a multi-threaded file system. It's not portable because it uses everything to do with 386 and probably never will be. But of course, that's all what he thought at the beginning, and why not? How would he know how it would take off? But of course, most of what he said there is no longer true. 1992, Windows 3.1 release. At this point, Windows became the most widely used GUI-based environment. I say GUI-based environment rather than GUI-based operating system because, of course, it was still based a shell that you based on top of MS-DOS. If you wanted to go into Windows, after you booted up MS-DOS, you typed in Win, and then that launched Windows. And here's a picture of Windows 3.1 to show you how, of course, different things are today across all operating systems, not only, of course, Windows. 1993, now this is important. So now this is just a year after Windows 3.1 and just after Linux has been announced, you've got Microsoft Windows NT. Now, the important thing about NT, the NT part stands for new technology. It was a new 32-bit multitasking operating system. So it built up from the ground, not based on MS-DOS. And ultimately it didn't only run on x86 processors, it also ran on DEC Alpha, on MIP processors, on PowerPC, Itanium, much, much later down the line. But Microsoft were working on a 32-bit fully multitasking operating system as early back as 1993, and that was Microsoft Windows NT. Now in 1994, you've got the V1 release of Linux, and it only runs on the Intel i386. 1995, of course, Windows 95 is announced, and it's still based on MS-DOS. However, it boots straight into it. So
rather than you have to type in start or win or whatever it was to start up Windows, it would boot straight into it. But underneath, of course, you've still got MS-DOS, because Windows 95 was very, very successful for Microsoft. And in 1995, we've also got Linux added support for the DEC Alpha, MIPS and Sun Spark. And there's an Alpha station. I had one of those myself when I was working for Digital Equipment. Fantastic machine for its time. Then between 1994 and the year 2000, because we've got lots of Windows releases, Windows 98, 98 Second Edition, Windows Millennium Edition. We also had Windows NT 3.5, Windows NT 4. Now, Windows NT 4, as you can see here in the picture, had a very similar interface to Windows 95 at the time. So you've got these two operating systems. One is a 32-bit multitasking operating system. One is the MS-DOS-based one with a shell on top, but they look very similar. After that, you had Windows 2000. Unfortunately, from a Windows point of view, at this point, Windows 2000 was the last one to support other architectures other than x86. So the support for Alpha, MIPS and PowerPC was dropped at that point. Then in 2001, something amazing happened. IBM pledged to spend $1 billion on Linux, which it did and continues to do so. And Linux really has become a key part of IBM's business model. We had the Linux 2.4 kernel released, and there was the first ever Linux Kernel Developers Summit. So by 2001, Linux is really taking off and is really getting some big money behind it. And then, of course, in 2001, we also had XP. Now, XP comes from the Windows NT line, as I was mentioning. However, it did a lot to make sure it remained compatible with the traditional Windows 95, 98 line. And it was the first consumer edition of Windows that was not based on the Windows 95 kernel or on MS-DOS. So XP was that merging point. It's really important because from XP onwards, we're really using that 32-bit and now 64-bit version, fully multitasking operating system, not the thing we had from the line from back from MS-DOS. 2004, the first version of Ubuntu was released as a big milestone. Of course, Debian and others have been released previously. The first version was 04.10, Warty Warthog. 04 is the year, 2004, 10 was the month. And Ubuntu keeps using that same numbering system even today. It's very easy to know which month and which year the release happened in. When we get to 2007, we have the release of Android. And of course, Android uses the Linux kernel. So the first version used 2.6.27. That was Cupcake, Android 1.5. By the time we get to Android Pie in 2018, we're up to Android 4.9.84 or newer. And now for Android 12, it's either a 4.19 version or a 5.4 or 5.10 version. And there are reasons why they're different versions, because it depends whether it's an upgrade or it's a new version, because it has to be able to support the old kernel and drivers and things for an upgraded device, as opposed to a new device, which can kind of launch with a newer kernel. And then from 2007 to 2012, Microsoft, of course, released several different versions of Windows. Windows Vista, the least said about that, the better. 2009, we got Windows 7, and that fixed everything basically that was wrong with Vista and was the most popular version of Windows ever, and is still run by quite a few lot of people even today, even though it's no longer supported. Then you had Windows 8, 8.1, and of course you had Windows 8 RT, which runs on ARM processors. That was a bit of a flop, but of course that does show that Windows, as it has for always with PowerPC and DEC Alpha, it's always been able to run on other hardware. It now runs on ARM. Of course, we'll talk more about that in a minute. It's now the ARM support is much more mature than it was back then in 2012. Also in 2012, we have the release of a very important machine, the Raspberry Pi. It runs Raspbian or Raspberry Pi OS, as it's now called. All uses ARM processors, ARM V6 processors in the original Raspberry Pi, ARM V7, now ARM V8. And of course, they all run Linux kernel and desktop and so on. So this has been a very key a little board in getting a kind of Linux out into a wider population. 2015, we have Windows 10, hailed as the last version of Windows, but clearly it wasn't, because we've now got Windows 11. But it runs on ARM processors, officially on Snapdragon processors, because it is Qualcomm that has been putting in the investment to give us Windows on Snapdragon. Here is a picture of the Surface Pro X, which I've reviewed here on this channel and used for several other videos. And of course, it's running Windows 10 and Windows 11 natively, because of course, it now runs on ARM as well as x86 and x86-64 processors. 2021, you've got Microsoft releasing Windows 11. I did a video on that. Microsoft, you should be ashamed. And Windows 11 has very strict minimum hardware requirements, TPM 2.0, secure boot. But that wasn't a problem for me. The problem was you had to have an 8th generation Intel Core processor or an AMD Zen 2 processor or a Snapdragon processor. And if you didn't have, like, even an Intel Core Generation 6, if you had a Zen Model 1 like I have, you can't run Windows 11. So I've got a lot of video about that if you want to go and check it. We won't dwell on it anymore.
Okay, so that was a look at how we got to where we are today. Now let's have a look at it from a developer's point of view.
Okay, so what can we say briefly about programming on Linux? Well, of course, Linux is a Unix-type operating system, and in doing so has maintained the kind of the programming interface and the philosophies and the way of programming that you would for Linux. So that basically means it's Unix slash POSIX compatible. And of course, that means you've got APIs for networking, for memory allocation, for processes, for threads, for semaphores and mutexes and shared memory and file IO and everything that you could want to do. And that interface is fairly standard in the sense it's POSIX compatible. So you can basically take a lot of software, and as you can see, you can buy a lot of packages that run on FreeBSD or NetBSD also run on Linux. Things that run on Linux also run on FreeBSD. If we get a commercial version of Unix from somewhere, you'll find a lot of its stuff compiles as well. And a lot of this is available via the GNU/C runtime library. So that's basically the whole world of Unix and BSD and Linux is how you do that programming. And I've got a video here on this channel called Unix versus Linux, if you would like to look at that to see what the differences are between them. Now, desktop programming on Linux is a bit different. You have KDE as one set of major libraries of way things are done, and you have GNOME. Now, KDE itself is built on Qt, so you've got some desktops and things just use Qt natively and then build their own stuff. KDE uses Qt, but then it has its own libraries that are built on top of that. And then GNOME has the GTK, and there are various versions of that, which is its user interface. So already you've got kind of two or three different ways of writing desktop apps for Linux. And that in itself has spawned so many different desktops. You've got KDE-based desktops like KDE Plasma. You've got Qt-based desktops like Deepin, LXQt, Lumina. And then you've got GNOME-based desktops, including the GNOME desktop itself, Cinnamon, Mate, LXDE, and so on. So lots and lots of different desktops. And then, of course, let's not forget the display servers. That's how the desktop and the display talk to each other. Of course, X11 was the traditional way of doing that from way back from Unix. And then you've got Wayland, a protocol that was meant to replace it. You've got Mir. And so if you take the combination of display servers and desktops, you can see that there's like just about every variation is possible. One will be using KDE with Wayland, another one will be using X11 with GNOME, another one will be using GNOME but with you can have everything. And that's part of Linux's problem, which we'll talk about more in a moment. Now, programming on Windows is actually, you'd think it would be a bit simpler, but actually it's not. So Microsoft seemed to have also created a whole bunch of different libraries over the years. You've got the Windows API, which was kind of called Win32, or the Windows Classic API. That was how things were done back, you know, kind of in the 1995 and so on. Then you've got the MFC libraries, and you've got WinForms, and you've got Windows Presentation Foundation, and you've got Universal Windows Platform, then you've got the .NET Multi-Platform, the API, you've got DirectX itself. I mean, the list is just so long, and sometimes it can be quite complicated to work out. Can I use that with C++? No, I can use it with C#, but can I use that one with C? And it's really, if you're into Windows programming, it can be a bit of a minefield. In fact, WinUI, I read in one web post, is the latest in a long line of graphical user interfaces and frameworks from Microsoft. So Universal Windows Platform there uses WinUI, and then there's WinUI 2, there's WinUI 3. It just, the list is quite daunting, actually, when you dive into it. But on the other side, there isn't that many desktops, although there are different versions of Windows, as we discussed, Windows 7, Windows 8, Windows 10, Windows 11. Basically, the desktop remains the same. Even if it does change, you know, the candy, the eye candy, that happens every 5 years or so. It's not like every week there's a new version that comes out and it looks differently. So it's familiar, it's stable. When you upgrade from, let's say, Windows 10 to Windows 11, you might have to do a little bit of learning, saying, well, this is a bit different, but fundamentally it's still Windows, which means it's familiar and it means it's compatible.
Okay, so that's looked at the developer aspect, what we need to know to write programs for these two operating systems. Now let's look at the market share. Where has Linux been successful? Where has Windows been successful? Where can Linux do better? Where can Windows do better?
So where has Linux been successful? Well, in lots of areas. Servers, for example. They, you know, there are different quotes about, you know, 90% or 95% or whatever of the internet runs on Linux. Supercomputers, all the top supercomputers use Linux, and here's a picture of the fastest supercomputer in the world, which actually runs ARM processors in enough on Linux. So that's pretty amazing. It's not x86, it's actually ARM. Then you've got, of course, Raspberry Pi and friends, you know, and all the things, the single board computers, they all run Linux. Android, of course, you know, billions of people use Android every day, and at its core is the Linux, you know, the Linux kernel. Chrome OS, again, I just did a video here on this channel about Chrome OS Flex. Try it on your PC. It's got Linux at its heart. So if you look at it, servers, supercomputers, single board computers, mobile phones, light laptops, Linux is absolutely everywhere. It hasn't succeeded in the desktop. And that's the one area where it hasn't succeeded. And so, of course, the problem is fragmentation, as I was talking about. So many different desktops, so many different libraries, so many different ways, thousands of different editions. They all look and feel. And I would say if you had three friends who were all into Linux and you said, hey, let's have a look at your Linux setup, each of them would be completely different. You would not be able to recognize, you know, one from the other. So one's running Ubuntu, one's running Mint, one's running Fedora, and the desktops are different. One's running GNOME, one's running KDE, one's running this version, one's running that version. And of course, if you say to them, oh, have you tried Linux? Well, what do you mean by that? Because which one of the thousands of distros are you suggesting that people use? Another area where Linux has not been so successful is drivers. Not in the sense that Linux doesn't support. Linux has got thousands of drivers. It supports a really wide range of hardware, but of course nowadays there are so many different bits and things you can pick up. So if you do pick up a, you know, a little Wi-Fi dongle, well, is it supported by Linux? Printers and scanners traditionally have had kind of problems supporting Linux. Your GPU, your latest GPU from Nvidia, does it have the right drivers? Is the drivers available? If you buy a special piece of hardware, you know, does it have a driver for Linux? And this is some of the areas where, of course, Windows is supported always out of the box. Whatever GPU, whatever scanner, whatever printer, whatever dongle, whatever bit of equipment you buy, it will have a Windows driver. That's just not even a discussion. But it is a discussion on whether there'll be a Linux one. And then gaming has been less successful, of course, on Linux. Games tend to be released for consoles and for Windows, sometimes for the Mac, less often for the Linux. Though, of course, things are changing now with the Steam Deck and Proton, and I've got videos about those here on this channel, which are opening up the way for Windows games to run on Linux. And as I said, the Steam Deck, all the reviews are coming out now about that, so that is obviously changing things as well. Another area where Linux has not been successful is because you can't basically get Adobe Creative Suite. And so you don't get Photoshop, you don't get Premiere Pro and all the other stuff. And for some people, that is a big stumbling block. And if it's not Adobe Creative Suite, it'll be something else. You know, whether you're into genealogy or it's productivity or, you know, video, music, you know, whatever it is that you're into, there'll be some suite that will be available, you know, on Windows, but it won't necessarily be available on Linux, and that can be a big problem. So then people start saying, well, can I run a virtual machine? Can I run Wine to do emulation? And then people ask a whole bunch of questions to try to be able to run the best of both worlds, and that can be a problem. So where has Windows been successful? Well, obviously on the desktop. So desktop and in businesses, home users, business users, enterprise users, they have all been majorly successful. And of course, in gaming, it's been widely successful. I mean, you just look at Steam and Epic Games and Origin and all the other stuff. They're all those games, big, huge gaming platforms available for Windows. And of course, as I said earlier on, wide support for hardware. Every little dongle you buy is going to have a Windows driver for it. Where has Windows been less successful? And that's in servers. OK, Okay, server editions, of course, exist, and they are out there, and they're not out there just in ones and twos. They are out there in big numbers. However, it's dwarfed by what you can by what Linux is doing out there. And of course, you've still got Microsoft Linux, and I've got a video about that here. So in the cloud, you can, of course, offer Azure offers native support for SQL.NET, remote desktop services, and other Windows Server workloads. They're all there in the cloud. But of course, it also heavily relies on Linux. And I've got a video here on Microsoft Linux here on this channel. And in other places, it hasn't been successful. Supercomputers, there are no supercomputers in the world that run Windows Server. That's just, don't even think about it. And then, of course, you've got small board computers like this Raspberry Pi, IoT devices, Windows Phone. Remember Windows Phone? Some people said it was brilliant. Some people said it wasn't. Didn't succeed, though, whichever what your feelings were about it. And so the Windows has not been successful in these areas. Now, what are the barriers to switching to Linux? What are the barriers to say, well, why don't I just take this operating system? It's open source and it's... And it seems to be available for me to download for free and try it out. Why don't I do that? Well, for one, as I said, the lack of certain bits of software like the Adobe Creative Suite, that's a big issue. Drivers for your peripherals, whether that's your Wi-Fi dongle, your scanner, your printer. If you're big into gaming and you want to get the latest game, I've got to go and get the latest whatever version of whatever, then your first thing is it's not going to be available probably for Linux or be compatible with Linux. And then, of course, you've got unfamiliar user interface, because although there are some versions of Linux that support kind of try to look like Windows to make it easier, that isn't always the case. And then, of course, unfamiliar administration tasks. Installing is different, configuring a printer is different, configuring your network is different, everything is different on Linux than it is on Windows. Now, there are easy ways to try Linux. Run it from a USB stick. I've got a video about that here on this channel. Try Chrome OS. Like I said, I've got a video on Chrome OS Flex here on this channel. Try it in a virtual machine. And again, I've got a video about how you can do that here on the channel. Try using WSL, the Windows subsystem for Linux. And again, I've got videos, several videos about that here on this channel. Try a Raspberry Pi. Go out and buy one. Get the cheapest one for only $10 maybe, if you can get them in stock, not trying to buy them from some dodgy third party. So there are lots of good ways to get into Linux and try it out without necessarily having to reformat your main PC and kind of go off into a whole new world that you're not sure about. You can try it in all these different ways. Now, of course, there's more. This is really just a kind of a scratching the surface. There are technical differences. We could look at the performance. We could look at the memory management. We could look at the file systems. We could look at privacy. We could look at security. We could look at malware. I haven't touched any of those. There are, of course, differences in all those areas between Windows and Linux and between Mac OS Windows and Linux. Now, if you're interested in those, any of those, please let me know in the comments. I'll see whether there's enough interest to put together a video.
Okay, that's it. My name is Gary Sims. This is Gary Explains. I really hope you enjoyed this look at Windows and Linux. If you did enjoy it, please do give it a thumbs up. Also, if you like these kind of videos, you can stick around by hitting that subscribe button. Don't forget, you can follow me on Twitter at Gary Explains, and I also have a monthly newsletter. Go over to GaryExplains.com, type in your email address, no spam, just that monthly newsletter. Okay, that's it. I'll see you in the next one.